Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Decoding Schopenhauer's Metaphysics, the key to understanding how it solves the hard problem of consciousness and the paradoxes of quantum mechanics, by Bernardo Kastrup, narrated by Robert Fass. Publisher's note: the print and ebook versions of this book include visual elements and a bibliography. You will hear these items discussed and referenced in this audiobook. The perfected masterpiece of a truly great mind will always have a profound and vigorous effect on the whole human race, so much so that it is impossible to calculate to what distant centuries and countries its enlightening influence may reach. Arthur Schopenhauer, in The World as Will and Representation. We philosophers are no thinking frogs, no objectifying and registering devices with frozen innards. We must constantly give birth to our thoughts out of our pain and maternally endow them with all that we have of blood, heart, fire, pleasure, passion, agony, conscience, fate, and disaster, life. To us, that means constantly transforming all that we are into light and flame, and also all that wounds us. Only great pain is the liberator of the spirit. Friedrich Nietzsche, in The Gay Science. Chapter 1. Introduction. Before we can discern the new, we must know the old. The adage that everything has already happened, and that there is nothing new under the sun and the moon, is only conditionally correct. It is true that everything has always been there, but in another way, in another light, with a different value attached to it, in another realization or manifestation. Jean Gebser, in The Ever-Present Origin. Born in Danzig, present-day Gdańsk, to German-Dutch parents in 1788, Arthur Schopenhauer gained recognition as a philosopher only in the last decade of his life, in the mid-19th century. His main work, The World as Will and Representation, came to light precisely 200 years before I started writing the present book. Today, Schopenhauer is best known for his psychology, ethics, aesthetics, and prose style. When it comes to metaphysics, however, his philosophy has been considered so obviously flawed that some people have doubted whether he really means it. This is tragic, for I believe Schopenhauer's most valuable legacy is precisely his metaphysical views. They anticipate salient recent developments in analytic philosophy, circumvent the insoluble problems of mainstream physicalism and constitutive panpsychism, and provide an avenue for making sense of the ontological dilemmas of quantum mechanics. As I shall soon argue, there is certainly nothing obviously flawed about his views, much to the contrary. Had the coherence and cogency of Schopenhauer's metaphysics been recognized earlier, much of the underlying philosophical malaise that plagues our culture today, with its insidious effects on our science, cultural ethos, and way of life, could have been avoided. With the present book, I hope to contribute to changing this regrettable state of affairs. In this book, I offer a conceptual framework, a decoding key, for interpreting Schopenhauer's metaphysical arguments in a way that renders them mutually consistent and compelling. With this key in mind, it is my hope that even those who have earlier dismissed Schopenhauer's metaphysics will be able to return to it with fresh eyes and at last unlock its sense. I admittedly interpolate Schopenhauer's assertions, that is, I fill in the gaps in his argument, in a manner that some may consider too, well, creative. Let me acknowledge up front that I may, in some sense, be guilty of this. In my defense, however, I offer the following contention. If one rereads Schopenhauer's words under the light of the interpretation elaborated upon here, one will find it difficult to imagine that Schopenhauer could have meant anything substantially different from what I posit. So let my interpretation be judged not by the wording of isolated passages of Schopenhauer's writings, but by how well it brings Schopenhauer's overall metaphysical argument together in a coherent, unifying, and clarifying way. I only truly discovered Schopenhauer's metaphysics after having fleshed out my own views on the nature of reality, a decade-long effort totaling 7 books, completed with The Idea of the World. I thus brought to bear on my read of Schopenhauer an extensive pre-existing background of related ideas and insights. 2 inferences could then reasonably be made from this confession. First, and on a positive note, that my own work equipped and primed me for discerning the intended meaning of Schopenhauer's contentions, despite his relatively loose and seemingly contradictory use of words. After all, I had just spent years wrestling with the same problems he wrestled with, working out similar solutions, and could thus not only understand, but also recognize Schopenhauer's contentions. Second, and this time on a negative note, it could also be argued that my prior metaphysical work imparts a structural bias in my efforts to interpret Schopenhauer. I am primed to read into his words a reflection of my own views. Both inferences probably have some merit. Let me highlight, however, that throughout the writing of this book, I have been aware of this inherent potential for bias and made deliberate efforts to avoid it. As much a reflection of persisting partiality as this very statement could still represent, I believe my analysis and conclusions are fairly objective. Readers should be able to assess whether this is or isn't the case based on how well I substantiate my argument coming up. Another confession. Schopenhauer initially attracted me because of his ethics, his way of dealing with the sufferings of life, not his metaphysics. I began my exploration of his thought with Christopher Janaway's little book, Schopenhauer, A Very Short Introduction. In it, Janaway introduces Schopenhauer's ethics by first summarizing its metaphysical basis, the foundation upon which Schopenhauer builds the edifice of his broad philosophical system. In the many quotes of Schopenhauer's works included in the book, I believed to discern, to my surprise, clear similarities with the metaphysics laid out in my own work. Naturally, I felt his points were compelling. Yet Janaway peppered his book with criticisms of Schopenhauer's metaphysics. What he seemed to be making, or failing to make, of Schopenhauer's words was quite different from what I thought to discern in them. Janaway saw problems and contradictions where I thought to see clarity, elegance, and consistency. But since Janaway is the professed expert and I was just perusing quotes out of context, I initially suspected I was reading too much into them. The only way to clarify the issue was to sink my teeth into Schopenhauer's magnum opus, the 2-volume, 1,200-page-long third edition of The World as Will and Representation, in the same translation that Janaway himself used. Although Schopenhauer wrote a few other books discussing more specific topics, The World as Will and Representation stands as his only work of systematic philosophy, comprising the main articulation of his metaphysics. In the ensuing months, I devoured the lengthy 2-volume set, reading and rereading it. I recognized in it numerous echoes and prefigurations of ideas I had labored for a decade to bring into focus. The kinship between my own work and what I was now reading was remarkable, down to details and particulars. Here was a famous 19th-century thinker who had already figured out and communicated in a clear and cogent manner much of the metaphysics I had been working on. What better ally could I have found? And yet, bewilderingly to me, Schopenhauer's metaphysics has had few followers. Its utter failure to impact on our culture for the past 200 years is self-evident to even the most casual observer. The present volume is thus a product of both dismay and delight. Dismay at how misunderstood Schopenhauer's metaphysics seems to be, even at the hands of presumed experts, and delight at the discovery that my own metaphysical views have such a clear and solid historical precedent. My goal with this book is thus twofold. On the one hand, I aim to rehabilitate and promote Schopenhauer's metaphysics by offering an interpretation of it that resolves its apparent contradictions and unlocks the meaning and coherence of its constituent ideas. On the other hand, and on a more self-serving note, I hope to show that my own metaphysical position, as articulated in my earlier works, isn't peculiar or merely fashionable, but part instead of an established, robust, and evolving chain of thought in Western philosophy. As an important bonus, by showing that Schopenhauer's metaphysics can be coherently interpreted in a way that reveals how much it has in common with my own, I also indirectly situate my work in the context of earlier Western thinkers, such as Spinoza, Berkeley, Kant, and Hegel, as well as Eastern philosophical traditions. After all, Schopenhauer himself explicitly situated his metaphysics in that broader context. It is critical that those who hope to truly understand Schopenhauer do not expect from him the kind of rigorous, consequent, consistent use of terms that is today characteristic of analytic philosophers. Needless to say, Schopenhauer preceded analytic philosophy by a century. His intended denotations of key terms are context-dependent. He may, for instance, use the term consciousness in the sense of explicit or metacognitive awareness in one context, and then in the sense of mere experience in another. Analogously, he may use the verb to know in the sense of true cognition in one context, and then in the sense of mere experiential acquaintance in another, and so on. Indeed, to understand Schopenhauer's metaphysics, one must read him charitably, always looking for the particular one amongst the various possible denotations of a term which fits most coherently into his overall scheme. The interpretational flexibility this requires is familiar to every non-philosopher in everyday conversation. Despite often loose use of words by one's interlocutor, one knows what is meant because of the context. Indeed, what makes Schopenhauer so delightful to read is precisely that he writes in a colloquial manner, as if he were trying to verbally explain something to the reader in person. So we must reciprocate and interpret him with equally colloquial flexibility. This is perfectly feasible, because Schopenhauer is delightfully verbose. He repeatedly recapitulates and summarizes, using different words and constructs, what he has already said. The argument in the present book thus relies on a context-dependent interpretation of Schopenhauer's use of terms. Based on it, I shall argue that the key to resolving the seeming internal contradictions of Schopenhauer's metaphysics lies in understanding the difference between phenomenal consciousness and what is today called metaconsciousness, or conscious metacognition, in psychology. I shall elaborate on this difference, show that Schopenhauer explicitly leverages it throughout his argument, and then explicate how it reconciles his seemingly conflicting metaphysical claims. I shall also attempt to bring out the overall sense and coherence of Schopenhauer's metaphysics by placing his key contentions in an overarching conceptual framework built upon the notion of psychological dissociation. I shall substantiate this framework with present-day psychiatric literature on dissociative identity disorder, a condition in which individuals manifest multiple disjoint centers of consciousness. On a more general note, the present volume marks an attempt by me to return to my original writing style, brief, parsimonious, to the point expositions. In other words, I've tried to keep this book short, no space being wasted on related but ancillary ideas, let alone divagations and digressions, so it can be read comfortably in a weekend. My objective in doing so is not to oversimplify things or acquiesce to the demands of a culture of intellectual laziness. Readers will soon notice that I may be guilty of many sins, but not this particular one, but instead to maintain focus and improve clarity. I prefer to be effective in conveying one key message than to be ineffective in addressing a variety of supporting or related ideas. The price of this frugality, however, is that this book requires attention from its readers. Sometimes a crucial point is made in a single short paragraph, whose importance is disproportional to its length and can easily be overlooked in a casual read. Still, in the spirit of focus and parsimony, I shall restrict myself as much as possible to only two key sources: the Paine translation of Schopenhauer's The World as Will and Representation, volumes 1 and 2, which I shall henceforth cite simply as W1 and W2, respectively, and Christopher Janaway's Schopenhauer, A Very Short Introduction. The latter I shall use as a source of present-day criticisms and objections to Schopenhauer's metaphysics, which I'll then attempt to refute. As for the former, because I aim to show that much of what I claim in the present book can be traced back to Schopenhauer's own words, I shall quote frequently from it. The many other entries in the bibliography are relatively ancillary, cited not to open up new fronts of argument, but simply to provide a more robust substantiation for my interpretation of The World as Will and Representation. The focus on the two key sources mentioned prevents me, of course, from further addressing the vast amount of secondary literature available today on Schopenhauer. For this reason, some may consider the present book less than scholarly. If so, so be it. Reviewing a multitude of secondary analyses doesn't seem, to me at least, indispensable for accurately discerning what the primary work itself has to say. One assumes that its author is the whole and ultimate authority when it comes to his own message. The World as Will and Representation is Schopenhauer's key articulation of his ontology, while Janaway's Schopenhauer, A Very Short Introduction, is probably the only text many students of philosophy today will ever read about Schopenhauer's thought. The former is the primary source regarding Schopenhauer's metaphysics, whereas the latter is, arguably, the most representative example of how that metaphysics is, in my view, misunderstood today. Contrasting the two is thus significant in and of itself, notwithstanding the remaining literature. It is my hope that the present volume contributes original and interesting views on Schopenhauer's thought, despite, or perhaps precisely because of, its focus and parsimony. Chapter 2. Brief Overview of Schopenhauer's Metaphysics. Our vital energy comes from a will which is wild, unprincipled, amoral. A universe which is not necessarily structured and limited by a rational, benign plan. One where we cannot touch bottom, but which is nevertheless the locus of our dark genesis. Something which comes from the depths has its own numinosity. The primitive has power on which we need to draw, or before which we stand in awe, even as we may have to limit it, resist it. Charles Taylor, explaining the ethos of Schopenhauer's philosophy in A Secular Age. Schopenhauer's metaphysics is characterized by a partition of the world into two categories, which he calls will and representation, respectively. The latter is the outer appearance of the world, the way it presents itself to our observation. The former, on the other hand, is the world's inner essence, what it is in itself, independently of our observation. This partition may superficially resemble a form of dual aspect theory. Indeed, at the time of this writing, Wikipedia listed Schopenhauer's metaphysics as an instance thereof. According to dual aspect theory, mentality and physicality are two different aspects or views of the same underlying fundamental stuff of nature, which in turn is neither mental nor physical. Whether we apprehend this fundamental stuff through its physical or mental aspect is a question of perspective or point of view. Those who consider Schopenhauer's metaphysics an instance of dual aspect theory equate will with mentality and representation with physicality. There is, however, no mention or hint in Schopenhauer's argument of anything that could constitute an ontological ground underlying both will and representation. No mention or hint of anything that will and representation could be mere aspects of. The only unifying ontological claim Schopenhauer makes is that everything is intrinsically will, representation being merely how the will presents itself to observation. As he puts it, the will is the being in itself of everything in the world and is the sole kernel of every phenomenon, whereas representation is merely the will become visible or translated into perception. For Schopenhauer, representations without underlying will would be like an empty dream or a ghostly vision not worth our consideration. There is nothing more fundamental than the will, the inner nature of everything, for as Schopenhauer repeatedly affirms, the will itself has no ground. It is thus at least difficult to see how dual-aspect thinking, as it is formally defined in philosophy, could be attributed to Schopenhauer. Schopenhauer is, in fact, an idealist with regard to the physical world, that is, the world of material objects interacting with one another in space-time according to causal laws. For him, this physical world exists only insofar as it consists of mental images, representations, in the consciousness of the observing individual subject. It has no existence beyond this individual subject. Schopenhauer writes that things and their whole mode and manner of existence are inseparably associated with our consciousness of them. The assumption that things exist as such, even outside and independently of our consciousness, is really absurd. A thing, for Schopenhauer, is a physical object with a certain form, occupying a position in space-time and obeying causal laws. Unambiguously, he claims that the demand for the existence of the object outside the representation of the subject has no meaning at all and is a contradiction. Therefore, the perceived world in space and time is absolutely what it appears to be. That the physical world is what it appears to be means that it is made of qualities such as color, tone, flavor, odor, etc. That is, it is constituted by experiential states of the observing individual subject. And that's all there is to it. There is no consciousness-independent physical world comprising separate objects with definite form, physical properties, and position in space-time which somehow correspond isomorphically to our perceptual experience. According to David Chalmers's classification scheme of variants in idealism, Schopenhauer's metaphysics can thus be considered a form of subjective idealism in regard to the physical world. But Schopenhauer doesn't stop here. He posits that behind the representations, that is, behind the physical world, there lies the world in itself, which is completely and fundamentally different from what appears on the screen of our perception. This world in itself is what remains of the world when it is not being observed, that is, when it is not being represented in the consciousness of an individual subject. The forms and laws ordinarily discernible through perception must be wholly foreign to the world as it is beyond representation. In other words, the world in itself is not physical. In it, there is no space, time, or causality, which are themselves merely modes of perception. The question that then arises is, what is the essential nature, the categorical basis of the world in itself? Schopenhauer describes it repeatedly as volitional states, such as an irresistible impulse, determination, or keen desire, which implies that the world in itself is mental. And although representations are also mental, the experiential states that constitute the world in itself are completely different from the qualities of representation. After all, what it feels like to desire or fear is completely different from what it feels like to perceive. Surprisingly to me, there has been controversy about what Schopenhauer means by the word will. Janeway, for instance, believes that we must enlarge its sense at least far enough to avoid the barbarity of thinking that every process in the world has a mind, a consciousness, or a purpose behind it. Nonetheless, I shall argue in this book that the world in itself, according to Schopenhauer, is indeed mental, that is, constituted by experiential states, even though states very different from perceptual ones. If I am
correct. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.